Good evening, everyone.
Good evening.
Good evening. My name is Byron Pittson. I'm an attorney, and it is my distinct pleasure to be here to help moderate this panel on behalf of the citizens of Flint, concerned citizens of this country, and everyone around the world who's concerned about injustice. On behalf of WADL, I'd like to thank them for having me here and allowing me to participate in this forum today. A central critical issue is obviously a water problem here. What is going on with opinions from our distinguished panel and from other concerned citizens of the city and whoever else has strong opinions and would like to voice them. If I may, we want to know what's going on, what's going on, and how we can solve the problem. If I may, I'd like to introduce some distinguished panelists.
Everybody put your hands together right here. Thank you for joining us. And we need to welcome everyone on behalf of 910 AM, the Superstation, a division of the Bell Media. We appreciate the citizens and the community of Flint, Michigan for allowing us to come here tonight for the Flint Water Crisis Town Hall. The Dell Media family feels very strongly about the impact of this crisis, and on tonight, the eyes of the world will be in this room. We'll be broadcasting on WADL-TV in Detroit, the Word Network, which reaches over 3 billion people worldwide and in 200 countries. In addition, we would also like to sincerely thank Debbie Kenyon, VP and General Manager of CBS Radio Detroit. Through this partnership, it will enable over 39 additional CBS stations to carry this town hall meeting across the state and country. Over the past few weeks, the eyes of the world have been focused on Flint. There has been disbelief on how something of this nature could happen in 2016. Something that will not only affect the lives of men, women, and children, but for generations to come. Tonight, we are going to make an honest attempt at giving an opportunity to officials elected by the people of Flint, community groups, and citizens to voice their concerns, to suggest their plans of action, and to discuss their fears and hopes for the future. It is our wish to present an open and honest dialogue. It is our hope to allow the voices to be heard that will aid in making the difference. Those of you that are watching right now, if you're watching at home, then you can join in the conversation by using the hashtag 910 Flint Town Hall. That's hashtag 910 Flint Town Hall. We're on, of course, Facebook and Twitter. Your comments and questions may be used on air during tonight's broadcast. Don't forget to go to the Word Network on social media, and the hashtag is 910 Town Hall Meeting. Now, I would like to formally introduce our esteemed host for tonight and moderator, who has been a steward of the people, nationally acclaimed attorney. Put your hands together for Mr. Byron Pitts right now.
Crime fighters,
closed down over 1,500 drug houses. You name it, we did. That's right, we did that. That's right. You name it, we deal with it. All kinds of crime, from Nook Nook to Junebug in the hood to Governor Sniper Hitler.
Yes.
Scissorhands Sniper. We deal with it all. I got a show on 910 AM as well as on WHBR.
I'm Jonathan Kinlock. I'm the host of the Jonathan Kinlock Show, as well as a longtime activist in the city of Detroit. Currently, I'm the chair of the 13th Congressional District Democratic Party Organization, the home of the Dean of the U.S. Congress, John Conyers.
Hi, I'm Dr. Darius, a longtime media personality from Detroit, Michigan, always on the front line for the youth, and also have a show on 910 AM.
Flint City Council for the 74th. Watch Wednesday, the City Council for the 5th
Ward. Reverend Denzel Jackson, National Rainbow Christian Coalition. We're in there, we're live, and we're right there every Saturday morning, 11 o'clock around the world.
First, give an honor to the Almighty God. First Ward City Councilman Eric Mays, the voice of the
Lord. And without further ado, let me, if I may, throw it back to our host, the Bishop Greg Davis.
Give our esteemed panel a hand again, please. Water crisis is a drinking water contamination crisis in Flint, Michigan, of the United States. Started in April 2014 after Flint changed the water source from treated Detroit waters and sewage department water, which was sourced from the Lake Huron as well as the Detroit River, to the Flint River. It is drinking water that had a series of problems that culminated with lead contamination, creating a serious public health danger. The corrosive Flint River water caused lead from aging pipes to leach into the water supply, causing extremely elevated levels of lead in Flint. Between 6,000 and 12,000 children have severely high levels of lead in the blood and experience a range of seriously health problems. The water change also a possible cause of outbreak of Legionnaire's disease in the county, that has killed 10 people and affected another 77. I turn it back to you, Attorney.
If I may, we would be remiss if we didn't allow, I think it's our honor, as it is to have every single one of these panelists up here. But if we may, I'd like to throw it over to the Honorable Reverend Jesse Jackson, a legend who we're privileged to have here.
Elected official they elected. They live under political dissolvers.
stomachs, know your babies. Who's the performance we should live your life? Worse than doing it, they didn't cover it up. This is a crime scene. Somebody needs to go to jail.
Protect me.
Jackson, thank you so much.
Amen.
Amen.
Comments, and I would also chime in at the same time.
problem that we suffer from in the city of Flint is gentrification. It's a form of depopulating this city, getting rid of the low, moderate income people, and bringing in people from affluent communities that has money and bringing them in and turning this into a college city. This is what this is about. They're tearing down our homes and not rebuilding anything, and eventually they want our homes and our community to look like University Park. Trust and believe me when I tell you this. They want Flint to look like University Park. It's going to be a college city, and it will not be affordable for you to move in. People make a statement saying $20,000 for pipes to go inside of a $6,000 home. Well, they don't have no problem with doing that. Quit saying that. Because in the long haul, they know they're going to have a $100,000 home sitting on something on top of that $20,000 pipe that they may put in front of your home because you're there only temporarily, unless we stick together united. Which he made that decision independently and without any of us shining in or making an input on that. I understood when I did my due diligence that that river was taken away from us and we were removed off that river due to pollutants and other issues that was questionable. And when he first moved over and they pushed that button, I knew right then that this issue has not been resolved. And so I rallied 200 or 300 people and a lot of them are in this audience right now. And we protested about the problem.
A snake is a snake. because one day it snowed in the desert. Snake came to the bunny rabbit, said, "Mr. Bunny Rabbit, you got a hole down there, and it's snowing out here. Can I please hide in your hole just for a couple days?" Mr. Bunny Rabbit said, "Come on in, Mr. Snake. You can hide in the bunny rabbit." A couple days later, Snake sitting in the bunny rabbit's chair, eating up all his food. And so the bunny rabbit said to himself, "You know, Mr. Snake, the snow is gone. Everything is all right. Everything is fine. Maybe it's time for you to head back out into the desert." The snake told him, "You knew I was a snake when you let me in here." And the same thing is happening to Flint. Governor Snyder, the snake, sent Darnell Early to Flint. The same thing happened in Detroit. Governor Snyder, the snake, sent Kevin Orr into Detroit. The same thing happened to E-Course. And so when we think about this problem, I just want to leave this with you. Do you really want to put in the hands of the snake? Do you really?
Get C minuses.
I know that's right.
They don't know how to fix.
single child damaged by litter. 700,000, 3 million, 8 million. This is bad. So as I let the audience and the panel get involved, I'm going to sit in my seat, and if anything you want to know about what doesn't happen, what should happen, because you got to get good information. And I'm here to tell you, we in Flint got sense. We come out of universities, we got masters and bachelors and PhDs, and I'm telling you, if the shoe was on the other foot, Snyder would have been to put me in jail. Thank you. That's the start of the conversation.
At this point, we're going to have some audience participation asking the right questions. I'm going to toss it over to Bishop Greg Davis, who is with an audience member with a question.
Thank you, Attorney Pitts. Again, those of you that are tuning in, you're watching all over the world, and this is Superstation 910, sponsored by Adele Media, and we're in Flint, Michigan, talking about the Flint water crisis. And we have Pastor Alan Gilbert, and you are Pastor where?
In Bethel Apostolic Church in the city of Grand Bay.
First thing I want, before you get to your question, what do you have to say about what you just heard from the panel?
What really has moved me most of all is that our elected officials have stood from the very beginning, especially our council, Councilwoman Galloway, Councilman Mays, and Councilman Davis. They all have been very strong and represented this city very well. And so what I would say, my question would be is that, first of all, is that we've been lied to. We've been bamboozled. And a lot of political shenanigans have went on. And I'm from an old small town on the Ohio River, the banks of the western Ohio River. It's called Owensboro, Kentucky. I've been in Michigan 42 years, and they have stolen our democracy. They have come in and taken over our city, and we just sit and tell them, we're not going to take it. And they say that many of us in the south of the country, we were ignorant. But what has happened here is ungodly and chicken. And so we have these elected officials to withstand them. They don't have any power because they represent the people. Right. So what I would say to Governor Snyder and Donnie Early and all the rest of them in Lansing and even in Washington, D.C. as well, minus our precious President, President Obama and First Lady, is the Bible says repent and be baptized, every one of you, in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, for the remission of your sins, and you shall receive the gift of the Holy Ghost. That's in Acts 2:38. Snyder needs to repent. We will forgive him when he repents. He has to repent. There are no pipes here. The people cannot turn on their water. They can't drink it. They can't use it to cook. Even me, and I've had pretty good skin all of my life, my face broke out, so I was really bad. So, in all seriousness, I'm really proud of our elected officials. They've been strong ever since this got started. They withstood everything that they brought into this city. They never bowed. They tried to represent us well, and I think that they've done a good job. And I would just say, keep it up. We're fully behind
you. Thank you so much. Listen, those of you that are watching, you can go to social media. It's the Word Network, the Word Network on Twitter and Facebook, and we will reach some of your questions. But you can interact with us right now. We send it back to Attorney Byron Pitts.
Thank you. Listen, one of the topics that came up over here and a huge subject matter on this panel is the stealing of democracy.
Right.
In throughout the state of Michigan, city of Flint in particular. I'm going to open up that subject matter, the whole concept of the emergency manager system, the stealing of democracy in really minority-run cities, frequently African-American, where power structure comes in, removes the elected mayor, disempowers the elected city council, and basically makes it its own fiefdom. So the question is, as relates to having an emergency manager, what do we do about this phenomenon in general? What does our panel think of it? And is it all negative? Are there pros? Are there cons? Certainly it's more to the detriment of this great city. We want to know what this panel thinks about the whole emergency manager system and what we can do to address
address any problems that were caused by said managers. Ms. Brickley, go ahead if you want to kick Steve Hood after that.
Sure. I was the corporation counsel for the City of Detroit Water Department back in 2012. When the state came in and tried to negotiate a consent agreement between the City of Detroit and the state and the state of Michigan, I filed a lawsuit in Lansing saying that that lawsuit was illegal because the state owed us a whole lot of money. And they were putting us under a consent agreement because they claimed that we were not paying our bills. And my position was, well, if you give us our money, we can pay our bills. Many of you all do not know there is still a lawsuit pending in the Sixth Circuit Court of Appeals challenging whether the emergency manager laws here in Michigan are constitutional. You would not believe it. If you read mainstream media, the news, the free press, they don't mention the fact that there is a lawsuit pending. If we really want to, and we are serious, 2.3 million people went to the polls and voted to repeal the emergency manager laws. And they want to make it seem like we don't vote, we're not interested. We repealed it, all I believe three counties voted to repeal that law. And despite our vote, within 5 weeks of that vote, they had come in with another emergency manager law. We need to be making noise about that every day. I am going to spend every time that I have with a mic in front of my face talking about two things, repealing the emergency manager and getting rid of Greg Snyder. This case is going to ultimately be tried on at least one issue. We need to make sure that courtroom is packed when it is tried. We need to let them know that we are not going to sit by quietly while they steal democracy and now poison an entire city.
Steve, go ahead and introduce yourself again to
Steve Hood, 6 to 9, AM 910 radio host, early morning drive time. You can hear me clearly in Flint because we have a Flint city signal. So we're here, we're live. You know, I was a little bit late getting here tonight and I was going to be in Midland. But I had to stop at the aquarium just 30 miles down the road. Because in that aquarium, I saw fish being treated better than you. Fish with cleaner water. Those fish didn't have an emergency manager. Those fish are well taken care of, but those fish don't have the power of choice. You all had the power of choice and it was taken away. The emergency manager law has done great damage to you. It has been proven that what happened in Flint was not about saving money. So if it was not about saving money, it was about making money. And we have to figure out who actually stood to make money off of you all being treated worse than a shark. Thank you.
This is a clear example of government not working.
This is an example of a governor and a state government and a federal government who failed to listen to its people. This is an opportunity for us to highlight the fact that when poor people said that water was dirty, no one listened. At the end of the day, yes, Darnell Early will be leaving out of his position as EM for the Detroit Public Schools. But so many other individuals who took oaths to protect the interests of the public should also resign. And at the end of the day, we must continue to keep pressure on the governor, pressure on the EPA, and everyone who has a hand in fixing this problem, because when the lights are off and we all quiet down, you residents of Flint have to still deal with this issue. So we failed you once, but we got to have your back as we continue to move forward. So what I am saying is that not only should the governor resign, but everyone in a DEQ who had a responsibility to make sure that they did their due diligence before they certified that this water was safe to drink need to resign as well.
Mr. Alicia Bobbs. Once again, I'm on Saturday at 7:09 p.m. on Superstation, 9:10 a.m. Family, this is all interconnected. I know we're in Flint, and I know a crisis has been inflicted on you, but I believe in going to the root or the origin of things. What happened to you? How did we get here? Well, it didn't start in Flint. It started in Detroit. 1999, the Detroit public school system, which had a $93 million budget surplus, a $1.5 billion bond issue, 184,000 students, no layoffs, no cutbacks, no taking away your pension, none of that, no school closes. And here comes the predecessor to Snyder. See, I'm talking about Engler and Granholm. And I'm sorry, if I hurt you, I vote Democrat too. But some Democrats ain't no good. Some Democrats is as bad as Republicans. 1999, the takeover of DPS, and they lied on Detroiters and on black people and black leadership. The test scores were going up, and statewide we tested in the middle out of the districts. But a test is not a full sign of intelligence or potential. It's a fact. They took over our schools, they lied on the duly elected board, they gave us a state-imposed board, they gave us a super-empowered CEO, the predecessor to EMs and EFMs appointed by MFs in Lansing, and they stole the money. They lied and said, we gotta close your schools because you're losing population. Close a school, you're closing the neighborhood, because one of the major concerns of parents is schools for my children. So when you close the school, you are decreasing the population. We were set up, and folks like Helen Moore and others, myself, misusing the Chicago, misusing so-called minority majority municipalities. Pontiac, Saginaw, Flint, Highland Park, Ecorse, Detroit Schools, City of Detroit. City of Detroit as a court system. We have to unite. If it happens to you, it happens to me. When it poisoned you, they poisoned me. We must all work together to restore democracy.
So when I heard about the Flint water crisis, it impacted me as if I lived here myself, because I felt that, and I feel what you guys are feeling. And I'm with Minister Shabazz and everyone else on this panel. Everyone that knew about this, from the DEQ, from the Snyder's office, the administration, I believe they all have to go.
By the Adele Media family. If you are you can hear my voice, feel free to go on the website or the app, the ADL Praise Network. Please join the conversation. If I can, Councilman Davis, please. Councilman Mays and Councilman Davis. I'm sorry.
If I may chime in and do a little Flint housekeeping. Once I got elected, I wanted to look at police service, fire service, fixing streets. But when this water turned brown, smelled funny, and was costing way too much, I had to pay attention. I didn't know nothing about bacteria, TTHMs, lead, or whatever. But you know, we got Google. You can Google stuff, and you got Facebook, and I'm thinking 9, 10, 8 and others, because Detroit can come in with media, and you got communications. Well, Councilman May started hearing from some people who is now known as the Water Warriors. It was Floralisa Flower. It was Melissa Mays. It was Leanne Walters. It was Tony Palladino, and stuff like that. Reading that is law. You gotta read law. Lawyers got involved. Shoshiro Young got involved. One of the first Flint lawyers. And guess what? Public Act 390 said that when there's a flood, a hurricane, whether it's natural disaster or man-made, it can be an emergency. And guess what was heated in there with flood and hurricane? Water contaminants. So Mayor Weaver, we threw the whole ones out. We elected Mayor Weaver. She declared the emergency. The city council rubber stamped. The governor was in a bind. He had to sign it. It went to the president, and we're where we are today. And guess what I said? Governor Snyder wanna work with us now.
Emergency So we don't have the elected officials in our executive branch who are doing as they are asked to do by those who elected them. We don't have the elected officials in the legislative branch. We don't have the elected judges because we have an emergency manager who is running the court, who has picked a judge from outside of the city and has funneled cases to that particular judge. Nobody in Detroit elected that judge to hear cases. In Wayne County, and only in Wayne County, there are a period of time, judges in Wayne County Circuit Court were not allowed to sign writs of habeas corpus. All right, that's the Constitution. I mean, that goes beyond founding fathers. So the discrepancy, the difference in the authority where elected officials are allowed to do their job, it's affecting every branch of government.
Now, for those that are watching across the world, because we're in 3 million homes across the world, 200 countries, explain to us what emergency manager means, because that term may not be familiar to everybody.
The governor, the court administrator selects an individual, puts them in control of the, if it's the courts, they're in control of the assignment of cases, the dockets, the operations of the court, things that the judges used to do. It is the legislative branch, and that means that this individual does not have to give a consent and approval, the vote of the city council if it may be, the school board if it may be. And if it's the city, the mayors of several of our cities, they have no input on how the government of the city is going to operate because an outside person, never voted on, has been put in that position. It's something like what we used to call a dictatorship.
Thank you so much, Judge. We appreciate you. Listen, we want you to come in also. It's not over yet. We want you to go to Facebook or Twitter, the Word Network, hashtag 910 AM, Flint Town Hall. We send it back to Attorney Byron Pitts.
Thank you very much, Bishop Davis and Judge Thomas. We have even more members who have joined our esteemed panel. I'm going to allow them to introduce themselves, and we're going to start from my right. Introduce yourself and tell the audience who you are, and we'll pass it down and continue the conversation.
David Alexander Bullock, Greater St. Matthew Baptist Church Change Agent Consortium, concerned pastor and activist in this the great state of Michigan.
Justice is done in the city of Flint.
You're right.
was cooking, and I don't want to cool down. So let's go. Let's talk about this emergency manager situation, because that's the problem. Because the emergency manager is nothing more than a servant of that government and taking away the democracy of our cities. So if I may, I'm gonna open it up to everybody. I know Councilman Davis has been itching to get into this conversation, and then Robert McConnell shall go next.
Well, I want people to know, and I think we're already aware of this, it's just another form of information, that the emergency manager law is nothing but pure dictatorship. This emergency manager law is to kill contracts, kill unions, and move us into corporate America. All of our schools are closing down because they're trying to move our children towards charter schools. Charters is backed by the federal government. Whenever you close educational schools down, you tank the livelihood of the conditions that they live off of, which is water, and you raise the living conditions to astronomical numbers where moderate income people cannot afford. That is another form of depopulating the city under this emergency manager law. A lot of things are happening under this emergency manager law that is really unconstitutional. But I'm going to give you an example of what happened when he was talking about the water issue. They moved us to the KWA, and people in Flint, I want you to know that there was a time when the city of Flint owned their own water. We get it from Detroit, we sell it to our neighboring counties, and we generate between $40 to $45 million a year. That was our money cow. Yep. That was the biggest bulk of money that we was getting that we could use that really wasn't, well, I guess it was earmarked, but it could be used. What happened is when they signed that bond into the Carrie County pipeline, the county owned 64%, we only owned, well, they owned 66%, we only owned 34%. The mayor, the former mayor, signed on that paperwork that if we miss one payment on that bond, we lose that. Everything that we owned in the city of Flint that was anything of value, we've lost on either partnership with the county. Don't get this twisted. Everything in the ultimate end is called regionalism. People are more prone in the county to vote than people in the city of Flint. And what happens is they'll be a part of our democracy, they'll be a part of our elections, and they will have more people in the city representing you from the county making decisions that does not have an impact on their lives or their family lives. This is what you have to pay attention to. The emergency manager hired a group, and I want to say this, you have to hear this, because I'm not going to leave them off the hook, because I was the first one to chastise them after I did a thorough research that they've been sued for 30 years all across the country. In Louisiana, they threw pollutants in the water, and they tried to pollute their water, and they was gone, going from city to city or state to state, privatizing people's water. And this group was called Viola. This emergency manager hired a group called Viola to make decisions on filtrating the water and treating the water. Broker Bocock, when he came here from Aaron Brockovich, he sat in my truck with me the entire day because I picked him up at the motel, me and the woman named Melissa Mays, who I met that day. Because I didn't know that she was going to be there, but I met her that day. And Robert Bocock sat in the truck with me and had a conference call with a guy named Bob Stewart, who was a water chemist in the city of Flint. Knows the chemical makeup of the Flint River. They have a strong dialogue. One of the first things that Robert Bocock said that he fears the most when he sat in the truck with me is that this group, Viola, which he was really familiar of, would come here and tell us to raise the level of the chlorine. Well, that's how our pipes got corroded. They was getting $900 an hour here. Made a two-week statement saying that the water was safe to drink. I chastised them on the day that they was giving the presentation, and some of my own colleagues were saying that it was inappropriate for me to do that. I said, no, it's never inappropriate when you got a company that only been here 2 weeks telling 90,000 people that the water was safe to drink. So this group should go under the bus as well, and they should be convicted. They should be convicted, and they should be in civil court, more importantly, criminal court, just like everybody else. They made inaccurate diagnosis of what was going on in our river, and the ultimate end is that they were really going to privatize us, because it goes back to what the attorney just said. Let's do the math. Everything in life is mathematical. 2 + 2 = 4, you can never get wrong. The doctor made a statement, let's use this 2 and lose my 2. He made a statement saying that this family was offered to privatize the water, right? They was offered to the water thing, right? That's what you stated, right? When they hired this group, Viola, I asked the emergency manager, did you do a thorough research on this company before you hired them? He said, no. I did a thorough research, and when I chastised him, the guy said, well, give me the information that you can claim that this is true. I gave it to him. And gave it to all gave it to each and every one of my colleagues, only one up here, but she's agreeing with me. And then after that, it was never talked about no more. They got the money, made their diagnosis, moved on out. But their intentions were to privatize our river with the family that he just named, that's a part of the Governor Snyder's campaign. See, I do mathematics, and I understand the equation. And once you do it right, you're going to forget it. So thank you very much. Each and every one of you.
You know, I think a little bit of experience with the governor's office trying to impose an emergency manager when I was county executive. And one of the issues that always came up is they said, well, financially, you know, we don't think that the county's going to be able to really make it in another 2 or 3 years. Well, I told the governor, if you stop cutting revenue sharing, if you came through with the money that you had promised us in the previous years, not only would Wayne County be in great shape, but the city of Detroit would be in great shape as well. Well, to say that sort of fell on deaf ears, I talked to a bigger big at the time, and they were just starting to impose the county or the emergency manager.
Yeah.
And I said, how's it going? I said, what are they doing? He says, you know, we go in, we negotiate. We negotiate with unions, and we do the things that we think are necessary. He said, in a sports term, what they keep doing is changing the goalposts.
Yeah.
Every time we come to what we think is the agreement that everybody's looking for, they change it. And it goes further back. They said, you know what, you're not making the mark. We have to bring in. Well, I think that's appropriate. From the Corporation Council said, emergency manager was brought in. And the emergency manager now with the legislature, what they're doing, it was the referendum was there. The state rejected, the voters of the state rejected, but what happened? Well, they passed it again within 5 weeks. But now they're getting smart in the legislature. Now what they say is that we'll pass a law, but we'll attach what they call an appropriation to it. Therefore, the people can't vote on it anymore. It's just a vote. We saw the straight party voting and things like that they've done, and they continue to do that. The emergency managers, and I, from perspective of what I saw, because as county executive, we were negotiating what they call the Great Lakes Water Authority for the city of Detroit and in the region. And during those negotiations, we suddenly realized that the emergency manager in Flint was making a decision that was hurting the people of Detroit, or the water system in Detroit, that was also being run by an emergency manager. So we went to the governor and we said, this is a conflict. You appointed both of those individuals, but one's trying to hurt the other.
Yeah.
The word was, don't worry, we'll take care of it.
Oh, yeah.
Well, yeah, they took care of it, all right. We see it today with some of this that has happened. Here's some of the fallacy, and I'll be short with it because I know we've got so many other speakers. Number one, the emergency manager in Flint ended up saying, we're going to save $6 to $7 million if we do this. Well, if you really look at the statute, what the emergency manager is supposed to do is get rid of the deficit, right? That's what they're really supposed to do. If he's saying that you're going to save $6 or $7 million, that would never happen with the transformation from the Detroit water system to what they did. Because you know what happens to that $6 or $7 million? If they save it, we could never really verify that they could, it goes to the ratepayers. It does, one penny of it does not go to the deficit that was in the city of Flint.
Yeah.
So there was no purpose to actually do it, to convert it over. So those are the things that when you challenge about what's going on with an emergency manager, not only do I think a lot of the things they do is unconstitutional with it, but it takes away the ultimate power that people have. And we see that they've done it throughout all their urban communities. Not only in Wayne County, you go up and down the I-75 corridor, and what they're doing is they're trying to strip the power away and the voices of the people. And you see them here in the city of Flint.
No more.
My heart goes out to you. I know how difficult it is. I have grandbabies myself. And to think about that they have to face what you face with your children and your grandchildren, it's heartbreaking. It's time that we make the people in Lansing responsible.
Yeah.
It's time that we tell them that you can't just make decisions. You know why? Because just like Wayne County, just like Flint, we deserve to be at the table.
Yes,
just
sir.
Like what you are when you're making those decisions.
Thank you. Pass it along to Pastor Sheffield.
I would suggest, Wayne, just, well, first of all, I'm glad to be covering and can't shout out a lot of people. I've been focused on my health, but I've given a lot of thought to this issue.
Yes, sir.
And I want to say just a couple things. I'm a philological, he's a theologian. Number one is that somehow or other we've got to find a way to come together.
Yeah.
All the issues that normally affect us in terms of how we don't get along and who's doing what, and it can be the right what if we don't like to who, then the what suffers, all that stuff we see playing out in this issue. Here's what I'm saying to you is that if this doesn't bring us together, if this doesn't afford us an opportunity to amalgamate our aggravations, galvanize our interests, and be able to change the whole topography of the state of Michigan, we'll never be able to do that. If you go back to Dave Bing and others who wanted to do poor clearance, remember that movie?
Yeah.
They called it poor clearance, or planned shrinkage is what they call it.
Yeah.
It really basically is poor clearance.
Right.
And all of these things that we see, emergency management, the water that's tainted, all of these things basically achieve that goal. So what am I proposing? Two things. One is, you've got to be benevolent. A lot of folks are saying, why we send them water? Well, we got to do the best we can. Whoever gives a cup of water to a little one should know why they lose their reward. But whoever caused a little one to stumble, better work for that man than not to have been born. And so what I'm proposing, Brother Booker, and I talked with Jesse, I talked with Elder today, we need to choose 2 days a week. Next 60 days, we can start running and go to the governor's office in Detroit. Lance, let's bring a bar soap and a towel and some water. Tell the governor we're coming to get him a bath. And I'm just saying, we got to put pressure on this man to leave office. We got to tell him to go. Do you agree with me? He should feel comfortable going anywhere. We should know what his schedule is. If he shows up in a church for worship, we'll get outside and cross.
And I want to go with a pipe here to come up. You know, one of my favorite quotes is, is that conflict is an enemy. Combat is optional. It's time for us to choose that option.
Yes, sir.
It's time for us to choose that option. I want to know where the legislation is to repeal this emergency manager law.
Right.
I want to know what line I need to stand in to register voters to get this thing done.
Yeah.
Eliminate the emergency manager law, okay? By Friday, they had a new one.
All right.
So it was in the plan. They already knew what they were going to do. I need to know from my legislators, where do I sign to get this done?
Thank you so much for the message. We have a question from Facebook, and you all that are watching right now. You go to Facebook or Twitter, the Word Network, and you can lend your comment. But Attorney Pence, if you would ask your panel, if pipes aren't going to be replaced, what is the plan of action? This is from April Roebuck. We send it back to you, Attorney.
Did the panel hear that question? Can we repeat that question, Bishop Davis?
If pipes aren't going to be replaced, what is the plan of action for long term?
Because you know what, Bishop, I think it's a powerful question.
If I can, just let me ask you.
Powerful question.
Let me give you a prompt, Reverend Alexander.
David.
Yes, sir.
Alexander Morgan. I would like to respond.
We're going to give him all his props.
I would like to respond to the question because it's a powerful question. Black History Month. It's the second day of Black History Month. 9, 10 a.m. the you get. And under normal conditions, it would be okay for people to clap for the second day of Black History Month, but that underscores the response to the question that I want to give. Go ahead, clap your hands for the second day of Black History Month. That's okay. 9, 10 a.m., 7 p.m. to 9 p.m., David Alexander Bullock Live. What we try to do is we try to very targetedly talk about some of the remedies for our problems. Great question. But the question is problematic. Why would we at this point even entertain a future where there aren't new pipes in the ground in Flint, Michigan? There is no other remedy that we should even allow to be acceptable, we should allow to be proposed, and that we should tell ourselves that if we don't get new pipes in Flint, that somehow we're going to allow ourselves to be comfortable with some other solution. We know what we want. We know what we need. We know what we demand. We know what we deserve. And so the answer is, do we have the political will, the spiritual fortitude, the organization, and the courage to get what we know Snyder has to give us? Thank you. attorney wants to give me a citation. Emergency management. Watch this. Connect the dots between the Flint water crisis and emergency management. Emergency management was a man-made crisis. You take tax revenue from cities, and then you declare financial emergencies in cities, and then you send your man or woman to that city to somehow cut their way to recovery. Now, surgeons, when they cut you, they cure you. But ex-murderers, when they cut you, they kill you.
In our lockers.
You've been detained in Flint because your property values have gone through the damn floor. You can't leave here, so you're in prison. This is a condition of confinement. So with that, the Department of Justice needs to be in here to negotiate a consent judgment so that whoever the next governor is, they are bound and they must repair every damn water line that is in here. So you have to get a politics office. But the thing is, you have to do it well with our sanctions. There's not an emergency manager, but then there is a person that is appointed as a court-appointed federal monitor to make sure that every paragraph that's agreed to is lived up to by the governor's office. Now, the third thing, Slick Rick the Ruler is going to try and get you to believe that the people of Flint wanted this, and the people of Flint recommended this. But let me tell you about emergency management. Under emergency management, there is this ruse of folks that have a vote. And it's a perfunctory vote, which means in layman's terms, it don't mean a damn thing. Because there's a financial review board that has unfettered power to cancel contracts or to issue contracts. Now let's get to what the real deal is. The real deal is, if I can believe Kilpatrick sits in jail right now. Right now, he sits in jail for allegedly rigging bids and pushing money towards certain folks. But let me tell you what an emergency manager can do. Emergency manager is a new form of no-bid contractor. So you follow the money, you follow where the money goes. You find out who got contracts for KWA. You find out who has contracts. You're going to be letting contracts for fixing the problem that they broke. Because understand, for that $18 million fix, there's a $1.2 billion remedy that somebody has to get a damn contract for. And the people of Flint who are affected most by this are not the ones that have the apprenticeships, are not the ones that have the jobs, are not the ones that put the shovels in the ground and start digging the dirt, are not the carpenters that rebuild these places. And then last thing that I'm done. Before you leave your properties, there ought to be an agreement that when you leave here, you hold deed to these depressed valleys. Because land speculators are going to come in and buy up this land, and rent you out, it's going to be remediated, they're going to buy it, gentrify you, lift it back up, and then pat themselves on the back and say, look what we did.
Not some of this other stuff that people is just now reading on, and then they jumped on the news TV
that they was putting corrosion control, which is called optimizing the system, back in March, which they lied, and then they tried to recant the story. They never had the equipment. Let me tell you, right? They have lied from the beginning. From the start of this. TTHL was discovered in June of 2014. That is a tier 2 violation. Tier 2 violation is a 30-day notification to the citizens under a CCR, which is a consumer confidence report. We called EPA. They still didn't do anything. November, they failed to violate, they failed to test again. Called EPA again. Spoke to Heather Schroeder. She's the enforcement team leader over in Region 5. She said, all right, we have to call them. That's how we got the CCR in January. That's when everything broke loose. Now in March, well, as a matter of fact, in January, Governor Snyder ordered water to the state residents or state employees. Everybody knew it, but we couldn't be heard. February, U of M did a test. They found TTHL and men. They called the mayor. The mayor said something, whatever, whatever. And they didn't care about it. In March, Leanne Walters' home was found laid, hazardous waste laid. Her son was lead poisoned. Let me tell you what these crooks did. These crooks went to her and asked her to sign an agreement not to tell anyone. They're good at that. I'm going to bring it all the way to the end of this because the people who you think are your friends and the people that you think are defending you are the ones with the slit down their tongue. All right? The ones that sit next to you and say they got your back, really don't. But they did, right? They did that. They said, we'll give you whatever you want. The EPA turned around and sent told them that they were sending lead experts here. MDEQ would not accept them. I called Heather Schroeder. I said, hey, Heather Schroeder, they would not accept the lead experts. July the 1st, Sue Hedman, which is the Regional 5 supervisor, she emailed the mayor at the time, Dane Wally, and told him, we have lead experts. August 31st, she sent me an email with Monica Galloway on it, and I took it to him live, gave it to him at 9:52. He called Dane Wally. Dane Wally knew I was going to expose him at the city council meeting. He accepted the lead experts at 2 o'clock that day. October 7th, we were back on Detroit Water. They were caught. They were caught, and they knew they was caught. What we have to do, while we have the media here, we have to get together, not just Flint. We don't just march one day. We don't march just one day. Like I told them yesterday. Just like when we got in trouble and our moms had company.
Brother Woodson, thank you so much. Okay. Give us 1 second. We do have to take a tap. We have a question from the audience. We're going to come back. We want everybody to be heard up here. Everybody's got unbelievable thoughts and opinions has contributed to this, but this is brought to you by Dell Media, and we are going to kick it over to Bishop Davis. We have another audience question. Bishop Davis, please. Thank you.
Thank you, Attorney Pitts. Again, we are 9:10 a.m. Superstation, sponsored by, of course, we're on the Word Network across this nation, across the world, and of course, WADL. And we have a citizen that is not necessarily from Flint, but the surrounding area. You want to kind of comment on some things that you have watched.
Back when,
where are you from?
I'm from Flint Township, right next door. Back when Governor Snyder was running for re-election, he had a campaign fundraiser at the Flint Farmers Market. There was a protest out there. The governor said that he didn't know the water was dangerous. During that protest, there were probably 100 people from Flint outside with signs complained about the Flint water. Now they have some nice outdoor tables with big umbrellas, red umbrellas out there. He was in there. I saw him. Some of his people came out, tipped those umbrellas over so they could not see the protesters out there, and their signs protesting the Flint water. Now, from what I see on TV, he used to wait, these dangerous lead pipes, poisonous lead pipes, will be recoated, and they won't have to do a thing. Well, they were lead before, they were coated on the inside of something. Something went wrong, and everybody's being poisoned. Is the solution really to recoat the inside of the poisonous pipes and leave them there?
If I got to go to college, oh my goodness. I like discovering new things. You get to see what works for you and what doesn't. That helps you evolve as a person. You get to make like a supernova of skill or talent or whatever it is. I've always wanted to go to college. I just feel like that's my destiny. My name is Queen, and I am your dividend.
I'm a teacher. Let me tell you what I make. I make learning a privilege, not a chore. And frustration, a tool, not an obstacle. I make working hard seem easy, and giving up impossible.
And then we're gonna turn on the lights and everybody look up.
I make an old subject feel like a fresh thought.
What's your reaction?
Yeah,
exactly.
And unconventional methods.
Okay, what else?
Common.
This is their world.
Nothing. And then they die. Go ahead, go.
I'm a teacher. I make more.
Teacher!
Tony Pitts. My office, the Law Office of Tatsuki Sheree, 248-228-8377, will also be assisting with any lawsuits because we do have causes of action here. I believe that classism is the new racism. Yeah. And they say black lives matter. Prove it. Make my black life matter. Make your black life matter by not poisoning my children, by allowing me to wash my hair in uncontaminated water. This reminds me of Hurricane Katrina. You had low-income people. You had people with a median salary range that was not great, laying on rocks, laying on the ground, and their hands were in the air. They were begging for help. They were drowning in flood water, but the people of Flint are drowning in drinking water. They are drowning in bathing water. And what that tells me is that they do not value black lives. But when you talk about criminality, what this really is attempt murder. What this really is assault with intent to do great violence. What I want to say is stop. Stop the lies. We do have remedies. Breach of contract. This is intentional infliction of emotional distress. This is negligent infliction of emotional distress. This is breach of contract. I'm talking about a contract with humanity. When you tell me you're my governor and you're going to look out for my human interest, you breach that contract because you had a duty and you failed that duty. And we have damages because we have people who are sick. Well, we only have physical damage, we have emotional damage. Look at the backlash. Do I want to turn on the faucet and drink after this because now you say the water is safe? Didn't you say the water was safe last year, but it wasn't? So now, what do I do with my emotions when I walk in the house? What do I do with my emotions when it's time to take a shower and I don't want to be touched by the water?
Next 20 years for
a $100 million bond. How do you, in a city that is under emergency manager, take part in such an expensive expenditure? So I begin to ask them, how does this happen? How do you, with the residents on 40%, so it said, in poverty, put a situation on them that for the next 20 years they'll pay $100 million? They can't afford that. Why are you not having them negotiate with Detroit? You're the governor. You should be able to negotiate a contract, because that's what emergency managers do. They negotiate contracts. They said no. So why am I saying this? Water is the new gold, you guys. Somebody is getting paid. We came away from Detroit. We were Detroit's largest consumer. When we left Detroit, all of a sudden, the Great Lakes Water Authority, now Detroit has to negotiate with other people and come into partnership with them. So now they're part of it, and now they become a powerhouse too. So you gotta understand, there's a lot of money in here. So the role goes back to, who are the people that are going to be getting paid by charging us in the city of Flint with the highest water rates in the nation? So it's bigger than this, you guys. We're just uncovering only the surface. There's a lot we don't know.
Councilman Galloway, fantastic. Once again, this is brought to you by Adele Media. We're going to kick it over to Bishop Greg Davis. We've got another question from the audience.
Thank you so much. Your name, sir?
Tony Palladino, Flint resident.
What would you like to say?
First of all, let me say that I'm
very popular.
Thank you. First of all, I'd like to say that Flint doesn't really have a voice up in here, because we got people that are running our business. As far as going in front of council, and then the screen tab board, and the emergency manager, and money that's going places that people really got to look at, it's like the Wizard of Oz, because behind these curtains, there are people grabbing this money. Yeah. My main concern is this. I kind of tear up thinking about having to take a shower anymore, and I got a granddaughter that comes in, you know how emotional I get. But here's where it is. When this money starts to fall, you damn well better start hiring people from Flint to get these kids and the people educated. And with that said, you better give us Eric Mays to speak, because from now on, we have no voice. I got a feeling they're gonna start slamming us. So please, Flint, pay attention to the people who've been out there. I wanna thank you all for letting us speak.
And you've been out there for 2 years.
I've been on here, we've been on here. Listen, Mays, I mean, look at Art. I would've known him. You got Leanne Walters, you got Eric. You got my girl, Claire, Clinton, I love you. But that's where we're at. We've been out here fighting, so I appreciate the voice. We gotta keep these voices in there.
All right, thank you so much. We turn it back to Attorney Larry Pitts.
Chief Connell, you know, a lot of questions about where some of the money is and haven't been in some of the negotiations in 2013. You know, they talked about the company from France, first of all, that was going to come in, and they were going to privatize Flint Water. Believe it or not, that was the agenda also of the emergency manager in Detroit, that they were going to bring in, I think it's Valera, I forget the name of the company, from Paris. They run their water system, was going to come into Detroit. And you know what the conflict was? Is that the person that was assigned by, at that time, Moore, emergency manager, he got a benefit in his contract. If he privatized the water system, he got like $10 million in a bonus for privatizing. Versus if we keep it public, then his fee would only be $2 million. I think they'd take either one of those, right, Councilor, at this point. So all these negotiations are going on, and they involve the governor's office, they involve his people, yeah. And the state...
We've got just less than, just under 5 minutes, so okay. We need
so the state, during the State of the State, he announced that he's releasing his emails and documents from 2015 and 2014. All the negotiations happened when? 2013. Release those as well.
Thank you. One minute, please.
Okay. I'm going to make this real quick. Tomorrow we have a protest. It's either pass the resolution or we shut it off. We're not paying any more water bills. Monday, February the 8th, we're doing a recall.
call petition at 2 o'clock. Be in Lansing at 2 o'clock. Speak to Quincy Murphy or Pastor Bullock. We need to pack the house. We're tired of all this. We ain't got time for it anymore. No more games. We ain't got time to wait for protests February 19th, February 20th. We need to do it tomorrow and every other day. Thank you.
313-590-1406. 313-590-1406.
Where is the protest?
590-1406. On Monday, we're going to Lansing. Tomorrow, Flint City Hall. This is not about black and white. It is about wrong and right. It is about dark and light. And so we must come together. Let's not make this a Black Lives Matter issue. This is an All Lives Matter issue. Government has failed all of us, and it's time for us to tell Governor Rick Snyder, you have failed for the last time. Now is, if you won't resign, then we'll recall you.
Councilman Davis.
Yes, I remember me and my wife, before I got elected, went to Lansing and we lobbied about Public Act 4. And one of the Democrats that we spoke to, it was with another lady, he said, I'm very fearful of this law. He said, because this law is going to take your city to the lowest it's probably ever been, and people are going to be ill affected behind this law. He says, and just remember that I am very leery about this law. And we went and we ended up getting 250,000 signatures with everybody across the state. And I guess 227,000 of them was okay. And then at the end of it, he hired a person by the name of Eric Ciccone, who was a law professor, no, not a law professor, but a professor at Michigan State University. He is an agriculture economist, knows nothing about urban community. And he is the one who functioned and helped put Public Act 436 together. I just wanted to mention that to you guys, that this law is about disenfranchisement, stealing our democracy, and taking all whites, blacks, Chinese, Hispanics, all low moderate income people. This is classism, just like the attorney said. And when I use the word genocide, I didn't use it in racial, I use it in classism. Thank you.
Ladies and gentlemen, my name is Byron Pitts, and it's been my pleasure to moderate this panel. Thank you very much. My profession is that of an attorney. I work for the law offices of Cornelius Pitts. Our office number is 313-964-7222 or 313-964-0066. Ladies and gentlemen, I want to thank this panel. These are some of the most esteemed people in our community.
Yeah.
Flint, Detroit, Southeastern Michigan, united against the oppressive forces who seek to steal our democracy. Ladies and gentlemen, remember, power yields to nothing but power. Get involved, show your power, and take your city back. I want to kick it over to Bishop Greg Davis. Thank you very much, everyone.
Not just a news story that's going to go away through the media and be gone in a couple of weeks. Flint, we've heard you. We will fight for you, but most importantly, we will fight with you. Again, we thank Ms. Debbie Kenyon, VP and General Manager of CBS Radio Detroit, and all of our partners. We thank you for allowing us to work with you. And we thank Flint for allowing us to come into your city, helping you understand more what's going on. Thank those of you that allow us to come into your home. We may have not solved anything tonight, but we have caused conversation. You continue to go to social media. The word that